Hi, so we are back again. In the first part of the talk, we have discussed a project called a crash course in biomedical, which is the final aim to produce a prototype for a course in biomedical for the general public. In the second part, we have discussed biomathematics, we have trying to define the possible branch, which in the end are not branch, they are just different flavors of the same of the same dish. They are error that has been developed. One of the reasons why I have those different flavors are, of course, because in the past it was not so easy to make communication between scientists or even some territories, which made it very difficult for scientists to communicate to realize that they were doing the same job. So that was the reason we have all of the different names. Here we are going to add as an extra part, which was not part of the main talk. This section is a set of questions that I was able to remember. There are questions that stayed in my mind. As I said before, the talk was amazing. I mean, the participation of the public was like incredible. It was one of the best talks I gave in years in terms of participation. I was surprised when I arrived, it was a huge amount of people. So I thank again for the organization that made that possible. And the public was no mathematician. The best I found in the group was a guy that seemed to work with neurobiology, but is not a mathematician. But anyway, by the question I saw that he was not a mathematician. The kind of question mathematicians should not do, because they are very important questions. You should question the cornerstone of biomathematics. That's the reason that what motivated me to give the talk and to what motivated me to give this crash course. I want the biologists, the doctors, the medical doctors to question the biomedical. Whenever biomedicians come to you from a mathematical model, you should question it a lot until they get crazy and until they start to make it better. The question I done by memory, unfortunately my computer, I tried to record the talk to put in the website, but unfortunately it didn't work. Somehow the program stopped recording in the beginning. I don't know why, it was a problem, a technical problem. But so I was able to remember some questions, not because I wanted, because this question kept in my mind when I left the talk. So I think I should put that in a video, because they are very important question. They should be discussed. So the question, as I said before, they are adapted. Some people did several questions in one question, and they did more than one question. So I have done an organization of my own. But the essence of the question, I believe, I hope it's the same. I have a good memory for some stuff that is important. So these are very close from what was asked. So, biological systems are unstable. Is it possible to model them after all? So it was one of the participants. He was one of the in the second row. And what he was trying to say, I believe, that was I understood that the biological system is very unstable compared to physics, so it's impossible to predict. And it's true, if you compare a biological system with physical system, biological system is much more chaotic, much more complex, much more unstable than it is for physics. However, this level of instability has a limit, and this limit can be proved because your body has a perfect clock. The cell are destroyed, the cell are created in a more or less specific time. For example, when you lose blood in about 6-10 days, you have new blood in your bloodstream, and your body is able to recover. When you cut your skin in a matter of time, maybe days, depending on the how big it was, the wooden. So in a matter of days, you are going to have a new skin. I mean, that's just possible if you have a stability on the system. If the system were completely unstable, it will disintegrate by itself, dissolve, or it not be able to come back to the structure. So you can say that biological system is unstable It is unstable on the molecular level, but it is unstable on the big level. So the instability of the biological system is an emergent property. So it's interesting because that's one example of emergent property. The instability of the biological system is an emergent property. It comes out from the interaction. So the system alone itself is unstable. It's true. And so that today one of the biggest theory to model biological systems is stochastic model. Stochastic model has been, which is part of my research, stochastic model has been used like largely in biological systems because it is unstable. It's true. I don't say that's not, but this instability has a limit. Then so that stochastic model is able to do good models. And now I'm writing a paper to a conference that I hope I'll be able to finish this paper by time, in which I'm trying to discuss that. So this instability exists, it's true, but it has a limit. It's true that a cancer cell itself cannot be predicted, but the overall can be more or less predicted that you have several models of cancer. In fact, the models, most of them are useless, it's true. But they can give you at least a small let's say insight. And of course, as time goes on, we are going to develop, improve the models. It's true, but this instability, there is a way to tame this instability. Maybe you don't know yet how, but I'm quite sure it exists, and it's just a matter of time to find it. Models should take into account the environment. If two twins, it was example she gave me, a student, she gave me this example, it was very nice, I liked a lot, example of the twin, it's true, if you, the twin are different, even you are different, your eyes, the two of your eyes, they are different, so you, because models, as I said before, biological models are stochastic by nature. So they are different. There is no way that we can predict that. So the case of the twin is interesting because, but I believe that even if you take into account the environment, suppose that you make a huge, nice mathematical model, then you can predict even the environment of the twin, you still not be able to predict the twins because the stochastic models are biological models are stochastic by nature. So there is no way. So the case of the twin, you never be able to predict exactly what the twin are going to be. You will be able to predict more or less how it's going to be. So it's true. The model should take into account the environment. But even taking into account the environment, it will not be able to make the precise prediction. One nice example that you can see that I have included that in a previous version of the talk. The next example I found in a book is very nice. Suppose a professor wants to show a student how to make mathematical model. Then the professor said, let's measure the falling of a stone. So the stone is left here, so you measure the distance, you want to know the falling time, then you have to apply just the equation of kinetics, the equation developed by Galileo and Newton. So you can make that. So after that, the professor showed the precision, it's true, it was going to be like this. Then suddenly, I want to see the ask, what about if we take into account a feather? So a feather is supposed to fall like a stone, but it don't. Why don't? Because there's the air resistance. So the professor decides to take into account the air resistance. Then the professor discovered that the air resistance is a function of the temperature. The function of temperature is a function of the amount of people in the room, is a function of the amount of air current that comes inside the room. As you see, the problem starts to get too complicated if you try to take into account the environment. So it's true. So a mathematical model is a partial piece of truth. It's not completely. So there is no mathematical model that is going to give you the exact description of reality. Your mathematical model is as good as you want. So it's a mathematical model in models as a general, they are just a model. They will never be able to replace completely the real system. Maybe they will get extremely close, such as you can never reach the speed of light, but you can get very close from that. So it's more or less the same reason. So from a scientist, I forgot the name, he said that every model is wrong, but some of them are useful. So that's the idea. The idea that model are very useful, but they're not completely correct. So you should use the model with caution. Should be careful that they have limitation. They were built under a lot of assumption, a lot of one of the trick of models to eliminate what you do not consider important. But sometimes in biology, this what you not consider important can be important at the end. Such as when you are modeling gene expression, what you do? You do like this. One of the approach that I have learned in mathematical biology, system biology, that you say that the gene is a two region, that is a promoter, and here there's a code region. So this produced RNA, then it produce your protein. The protein is produced. So that's the system that you have, the just like three states. But the truth, because in this middle here, you have huge amount, have splicing, you have problem to make the RNA, have transportation, the RNA that make transportation. It's true, between this one has huge amount of process, and we neglect it. But because you do not want how much will get complicated. But anyway, a mathematical model or a model in general will be as complicated as you want. But as easy it is complicated, it starts to get too difficult to solve. But even in physics, the models are limited. I mean, the physicists do not like to admit it, but they are limited. Because they are a limited representation of reality. They are a way that we found, but they are very useful. So the fact that a model is limited doesn't mean that you should not use models. Models are a very nice way to get like some kind of insight about what's going on. So biology is not too complicated. Biology is not physics. For instance, in gene expression, there are several processes between gene expression and after. And it's true, as I explained before, it is that there exists a huge amount of process that we have to neglect. And biology is complicated, I know. It is, but in fact, biology is not in fact not like to use complicated, because a plane is complicated. But a plane is not complex. In general, I like to say that biology is complex. Complex and you somehow the new concept that complex means that you cannot explain everything. Complicate means that it's too much. So a plane has a huge amount of piece. But if you give enough time, you can understand how a plane works. But a biology is not always true. Even simple biology still cannot be understood properly, such as some gene expression, so on, not be understood properly because it's too complex. It's not compl it's complicated, but it's also complex. But most of the case, biology is not complicated. It's complex. I mean, you can you know that the amount complicated has to do with too much parts. And the complex has to do with the inability to understand it from a theoretical point of view. Indeed, biology is not physics, but there is some kind of way to learn from physics. So the idea of mathematics is not to say that biology is physics. I mean, of course, several mathematicians, I believe they say that. Instead of physicists, they say that. First of all, if you see one example, there's a nice talk in the internet between Richard Hawking and another scientist from physics, and see that Hawking has a Richard. Richard Hawking has problems talking to the guy. So, see, the physicists, they are difficult to talk to, and it's true. So, the best way to destroy that is that biologists start to take the wheels of this situation. First, indeed, in gene expression, it's complicated. So, the point is that we need to make the demarcation of the territory, and it can be done just by group work. Biology is too chaotic. For instance, in cancer, we cannot predict for sure the dynamic. It's too quite different from cell to cell, from time to time. It's true. It's too chaotic. That's why you have to use stochastic models in cells. In some, that's why stochastic model has been quite, let's say, used a lot in biology. But it has other theories, such as called the hybrid system. A hybrid system is a way for each model system that has different dynamics. So system that has dynamic that is changing with time, change situations, is called a hybrid system. I'm not expert in hybrid system, but I have some of my friends who they work with hybrid system because they apply it for control that are in some situations are not from biology, are from communication technology, ECT. information communication technology, and it most of it can be adapted. I have not seen too much work on that direction, but I believe that could be a nice way to investigate. Biology has already done a lot. Do you really need biomathematics? This question was done by one of the guys. I'm not sure. I felt some kind of hostility. I felt that he was not very happy with the situation. But anyway, maybe I was wrong. But indeed, biology has done a lot. But the problem that biology and the medicine has been done has been repeating work, such as several guys do the same work. But if you have law, if you have the general principle, you can avoid a situation can be repeated because you can see it by model. So that's what they have done. They have done in physics and they have done in like doing biology. A physicist will never go to the lab without making the math. So, but not the case for the biology. So some experiment can be explained by the same set of law that's experienced from physics. But if you cannot do exactly the same in biology, at least you can get close. And can there is a nice paper that I would like to discuss in the future in this project, which was written by Sarah Green. I talked to her by social network. She seems very nice, and she got very interested by this project when I told her, and I plan to discuss her paper. And on that paper she discussed the need to take it easy with biology, to make the laws when you see the word generalization. This is a generalization of the situation. Physics is very, very strict, but you need to take it easy in biology. And that's the case. Maybe you cannot make general law for all policies, but you can make general law for a small situation, such as there are general law for gene expression. So it's already a good starting. So it's already a good point. So the general law, the laws, the general principle in biology, certainly they will be more locally than globally. So that's one of the difference. So in modeling, it's interesting to go backward and forward. Indeed, that's I'm not sure if I understood properly the question that was done by Anna, the organizer. It was a major question. Indeed, you can go backward and forth. So this question can be answered in two ways. One way is the fact that in the traditional way, they thought that you could start from gene and predict the organism. This view somehow got some problem because the interaction of the environment influences that. So cannot do that just by this way. You need to take into account the environment, what another student asked me. So in the book, The Music of Life, written by Dennis Noble, he explained a little bit this kind of idea in very nice ways. But so if you try to go back and forth in this way, unfortunately you have some limits for that. We, like in quantum mechanics, we have problem to connect a top-down and a bottom-up approach. That's why the middle way of the approach was proposed. It's not as possible. There's some blind point here that you cannot go further at the moment with your current limitations. There is blind points, so they cannot go in the whole system. It's difficult to go backward and forth. Maybe it's impossible. But we are talking about in small context called the midway out approach, in which you take a point of model such as the tissue, and you go let's say upward to understand, and go downward to understand. So you start from a point of reference and go up and down. So this is called the midway out approach. So the holistic paradigm is not new. It had already been done before due to lack of technology. It's true. The classic way of seeing nature was by the Greek was done like that. They used to see the system as an organic. It's the organic view, holistic view of nature is not new. It's very old, but has been forgotten. So most of the idea that trying to bring it back to biology now, they are somehow old, but were somehow forgotten. The difference is that now we have enough technology to make it better. Before it was just philosophy. People was make philosophy about the system in a holistic point of view. Now we can make it more. We can make the math and make the simulation. So it's true, somehow. But most of the cases, it was not holistic. It was physiology. Physiology can seem like holistic, but it's not holistic. Physiology sometimes can make the mistake to think that a physiological approach, which is a top-down approach, is a holistic, but it's not necessary. Holistic has to do if we see the system as a whole, without cutting the system open, without without taking the parts out, but you see the system as a whole, as working. You see the car when it's on, not when it's off. So you see the system working, it's working in its environment. So it's called the holistic paradigm. It's a, people are not, now are using new words such as organic, and they call the ecological standpoint. Anyway, the people prefer another term, but it's more or less the same. So this modeling are the challenge of the millennium. Indeed, I have done that was by the student that worked with neurobiology. We talked after the presentation. He said that we keep in touch. I hope that we keep in touch because he seems very interested, and his ideas seems to be very interesting as well. Indeed, I have wrote that in a paper 2 years ago, unfortunately in Portuguese, in which the theme of the symposium was the challenge of the millennium. And I have said that biology is one of the challenges of the millennium. It's true. Biomathematics, biology in general, will be the challenge of the earth. It will be the leading car. Physics has lost somehow the prestige and son of science. Now we have another one, it's called biology, biomathematical biology, as you want to call it. So what is mod can you really do? What are the limitations? In fact, biomedical has a huge amount of limitations. So this unreasonable effectiveness, I believe it does not yet exist, because biomedical is not still effective in biology. Most of the moratorium models, they are just more, even the complicated model to go to computer, they still cannot do too much. Their predictions are very limited. There is no general law, so they are very limited. They have done, I mean, there's amazing, let's say, theory out there, but they're still limited. So the next challenge is how to destroy this limitation. The only way they can do that is biologists work with mathematicians, that's what called biomathematics. So that's the one way that most of the effort I have seen that they are doing by mathematicians, physicists. So by this way, we never get far away. We never go. That could be just an illusion. You cannot. The only way that can really destroy this limitation, make the limitation very clear, to find what is the problem, why biomedical is limited, is by working together, like you work as a group. Model never replaces human. It's true. There is a very nice sentence I saw in a kind of interview. It was by a young Brazilian. She's very young, and she said something very nice that the next challenge of that's coming now is to be human. Indeed. But the point of biomathematics is not to replace a human. To replace the kind of activity that can be done easily by machines, such as if you have 1,000 X-ray plates to analyze and you have to identify there is a broken bone. Some situations are very easy to identify. There is no reason a doctor needs to do that. Can you apply an image process technique and the computer will tell you. Then what you can do is to supervise the computer to be sure that there is no mistake. There are several cases of very easy doctors activity that can be automated. But of course, like any error, like if I give you a gun, you can decide to defend yourself, you can decide to kill someone. So the way people use technology is not a matter of the technology, it's a matter of who are going to use that. So I can create super system that can cure anyone. People can use that to cure the poor people from the poor poor place. We can use that in a war. So it's not a matter of technology, it's a matter of it's a philosophical issue, it's an ethical issue.